emergency in Virginia after a white supremacist turned violent. Governments may take legal action against unauthorized modifications at the scene of yesterday's deadly fire in Kwajalein.
很多打工者一樣,每日都搏到盡。退休,未諗啊。
The NPF Default Investment Strategy, or DIS, has been launched.
Good evening. State of emergency is now in place in the U.S. state of Virginia after a gathering of hundreds of white supremacists turned deadly. A car plowed into a group of counter-protesters, leaving one dead and dozens injured. Video captured the terrifying moment when a car slammed into a crowd of people, knocked them into the air and in every direction. Among the road rage victims, a 32-year-old woman was killed, and several others were left bleeding from various wounds. Witnesses say the driver intentionally targeted those protesting against white supremacists in a Unite the Right protest.
It was a very narrow street, and he sort of slowed down and then just slammed into them very, very hard.
The driver then backed up and dragged at least one person he had already hit. Police arrested 20-year-old James Alex Fields Jr. as the suspected driver of the crash. His mother was shocked to learn he had been charged with second-degree murder.
I didn't know it was white supremacists. I thought it had something to do with Trump. Trump's not a supremacist.
The deadly event erupted after 2 days of chaotic protests consumed the college town of Charlottesville over a plan to remove a statue of Confederate general and war hero Robert E. Lee. A U.S. federal judge ordered city authorities to allow the protests by white nationalists and other extremists. The move sanctioned a torch-lit parade through the city in what critics say was eerily reminiscent of Nazi Party propaganda events. But tensions boiled over 2 hours after police shut down Friday's Unite the Right protest at a nearby park.
Look, we're being gassed now. The Charlottesville Police Department is allowing people to come in here, gas us. They won't allow us into the event, even though we had a permit.
If you do not disperse immediately, you will be arrested.
The state's governor called a state of emergency and blamed neo-Nazis for sparking the unrest. Still, counter-protesters fought pitched battles with far-right protesters using rocks and pepper spray. Often blamed for empowering white supremacists, what many call Donald Trump's hateful rhetoric on the campaign trail, the president condemned the violence and called it bigotry.
We condemn in the strongest possible terms this egregious display of hatred, bigotry, and violence on many sides. On many sides. It's been going on for a long time in our country. Not Donald Trump, not Barack Obama. It's been going on for a long, long time. It is no place in America.
Great people. Then he called for unity.
But the hate and the division must stop. And must stop right now. No matter our color, creed, religion, or political party, we are all Americans first.
But the chaos triggered another tragedy when a helicopter monitoring the crisis from above crashed in a wooded area. 2 police officers were killed as a result.
U.S. President Donald Trump is set to order his top trade advisor to decide whether to investigate certain Chinese trade practices that are deemed to harm American interests. The move could lead to steep tariffs on Chinese goods. Comes at a time when Trump has asked Beijing to do more to crack down on North Korea's missile program as he threatens possible military action against Pyongyang. Jeff Tang reports.
It's no secret that Washington wants Beijing to throw its weight behind efforts to stop North Korea's missile programs. It seems the White House is also willing to use steep tariffs on imports as leverage to force China to help rein in Pyongyang. U.S. President Donald Trump said so himself just a few days ago.
Look, we have trade with China. We lose hundreds of billions of dollars a year on trade with China. They know how I feel. It's not going to continue like that. But if China helps us, I feel a lot differently for trade.
This comes as anonymous White House officials revealed that Trump plans to sign an executive order tomorrow to invoke Section 301 of the Trade Act of 1974. It would allow the president to unilaterally impose tariffs or other trade restrictions to protect U.S. industries from unfair trade practices of foreign countries. Trump is expected to call on U.S. Trade Representative Robert Lighthizer to determine if such a probe is warranted. Washington has long accused China of forcing U.S. firms operating on the mainland to turn over their technologies and intellectual properties. However, some in the White House sang a different tune overnight. A U.S. administration official denied that trade action was a pressure tactic and insisted diplomacy over North Korea and the potential trade probe were totally unrelated. In a telephone conversation between Trump and Chinese President Xi Jinping on Friday, the pair were said to have reiterated their mutual commitment to denuclearize the Korean Peninsula. But it was unclear whether the issue of trade came up. Meanwhile, Trump also spoke on the phone with French President Emmanuel Macron yesterday. The pair were said to have agreed to confront the increasingly dangerous situation associated with North Korea's destabilizing and escalatory behavior. Satellite images released by military analysis website 38 North suggests that Pyongyang may be accelerating the development of the sea-based component of its nuclear forces. Netting on top suspended above a Simpo-class submarine suggests that the North may be preparing to test launch its Pukguksong-1 ballistic missiles at sea. At the center of all the chest beating between Washington and Pyongyang is Guam, the Pacific island that North Korea has vowed to complete a plan to attack nearby waters this week. The U.S. territory's Catholic faithful attended Sunday Mass as usual, with the island's 26 churches instructed to offer prayers for peace between the two nations and courage for Guam's military forces. Jeff Tang, TVB News.
For the second day in a row, mainland military forces have sent aircraft flying off the east coast of Taiwan. According to Taiwan's armed forces, two Y-8 airborne early warning planes were detected to the south of the island this morning, heading northeast over the Bashi Channel. The Y-8s were accompanied by two Su-30 fighter jets of the People's Liberation Army Air Force. The planes then headed north and flew over the Miyako Strait off northeastern Taiwan before returning to the mainland. It was the third time so far this month that PLA aircraft had flown over international waters off Taiwan's east coast. Mainland media reports said earlier that such long-distance flights could become the PLA Air Force's normal activities in the future.
Turning to local news, the authorities are still looking into the cause of a fire that killed three people in Kwaichung yesterday. The buildings department confirmed the industrial building unit where the fire started was subdivided illegally. Caleb Leung has more.
The fire broke out at around 6 p.m. yesterday at Maysik Industrial Building in Kwaichung. It was reopened this morning, but an investigation into the blaze is still ongoing. The unit where the fire broke out was located on the 10th floor. It was subdivided into 17 rooms. Sources said one of these rooms was used as a gathering place, and alcohol and bartender tools were found there. A woman who attended church on the 8th floor went to the 10th floor to take a peek at the fire scene.
They have some ashes, like dark color, like that, and then you can see the picture just like that, burn, a little bit burn, I think. And then the floor is dark color. I think that's what happened last night.
One of the men killed in the fire was a part-time bartender. Sources said he would practice his magic tricks in the room where the fire started. The men sometimes used phosphorus powder, a flammable material, as a tool. However, investigators found no magic tools or phosphorus powder in the room. The building's department confirmed the unit was subdivided without prior approval. It says some of the modifications made at the unit, including the materials used, do not meet safety standards. The department says it may take legal action against the modifications. Maysik Industrial Building, built in 1972, is not required to have a fire sprinkler system. A real estate agent said most of the units in the building are used for storage or production purposes, such as preparing food. However, the agent said it's difficult to say whether the units were being used for other purposes. Secretary for Security John Lee said his bureau plans to introduce a bill to the Legislative Council to enhance fire safety at old industrial buildings. The bill would require these buildings to take extra fire prevention measures, such as installing sprinkler systems. Peter Bloom, TVB News.
Is their pathway straight or curved? There's no need to follow others. Make your own choice.
Vocational and professional education and training covers a wide range of occupations and includes relevant programs up to degree level. It provides practical training to better prepare the younger generation for their future careers and helps them to enter a profession. VPET, leading you to a professional pathway.
From the 1st of May 2017, the statutory minimum wage is raised to $34.50 per hour.
Deposed Pakistani leader Nawaz Sharif called for a change and a revolution in the country to ensure the sanctity of the vote. This came after the Supreme Court disqualified him for concealing assets. Concluding his four-day journey, which began in Islamabad and culminated in a rally in Lahore, Poe's prime minister addressed the tens of thousands who gathered near the famous shrine of Data Darbar. Following his removal from office last month, Sharif traveled from Islamabad and stopped over in three other cities. He said he saw that citizens had not accepted the court's decision and asked his supporters to await his next move without elaborating. Sharif also asked why he would be removed when he was moving the country towards progress.
Latin American nations have come out strongly against U.S. threats of military action against Venezuela. The sudden change of heart comes after they spent months attacking their crisis-hit neighbor's unpopular leader. Venezuela was on the verge of becoming a pariah over its recent installation of a legislative superbody. The move has been widely condemned as a power grab by the ruling socialists under President Nicolas Maduro. Then came Donald Trump's surprise assertion on Friday that U.S. military intervention in Venezuela was an option. That had Maduro's critics stuck between backing a foreign invasion of their neighbor or supporting a leader they call a dictator. Peru, one of Maduro's fiercest critics, led the charge in criticizing Trump's threat, saying it was against UN principles. Mexico and Colombia joined in with statements of their own.
And still ahead in our newscast, a plan to bring in domestic helpers from Cambodia. A record-setting finger painting in celebration of the SAR's 20th anniversary. And Usain Bolt pulls up injured in the final race of his career.
你解电的服务的时候，有几点要留意？唔好作答，又已出啊！你解嘅服务一定要自己啱用，唔明白啲收费同服务条款，要问清楚，唔好为咗收费优惠或者礼品轻易签约啊！电信服务选择多，不妨花啲时间比较下。总之要清楚晒啲合约内容，先好签约啊！电信服务选择多，签约前要谂清楚。
香港是中国的一部分，我哋更加要爱护祖国。我大个咗要保家卫国。有事。不过香港人系唔使当兵嘅，因为香港特区嘅防务由中央负责。咁我哋使唔使被军费呢？
根据基本法，特区系财政独立，唔使上缴中央统兵费噶。
我明啦，祖国同香港。
睇住啦。
职业安全，以策万全。饮食业工友， 使用刀具及机器时要小心及专心啲，地面要保持光爽清洁，运送滚热嘅食物时要提醒旁人啊！资料由职业安全健康局带俾你。从今日起，你要爱惜生命，一切未定，但我对你尊敬。
最低有關入息水平已經提升至7100元。
Recounted his trip to Cambodia earlier this month in a blog post today. Law said he spoke to Cambodian labor officials and women's groups during his trip. They were all concerned about one thing, that Cambodians would initially have a hard time fitting in. Law said the Hong Kong government has already taken steps to help potential Cambodian domestic helpers, such as adding Khmer to the languages available on the Labor Department's Foreign Domestic Helpers website. Back in March, the government also relaxed visa restrictions for Cambodians working in Hong Kong. But speaking at an event today, Undersecretary for Labor and Welfare Caspar Choi said it's still unclear whether the first batch of 1,000 Cambodian domestic helpers could arrive on schedule. It would depend on the progress of the Cambodian government, he said. Meanwhile, there are calls to improve the quality of life of domestic helpers already working in the city. One problem is many of them have nowhere to go during their days off. About 20 years ago, the government handed the management rights of this old school campus in Kennedy Town over to Filipino domestic worker groups. Back then, authorities were hoping it could become a place for them to gather and hold events. But worker groups say it is not enough.
More domestic workers trying to go there if they didn't have any appointment in going there, because they think that it's quite far, and the second thing is it's also small, and sometimes it's all occupied, so there's no space.
The Home Affairs Department says the management of the building belongs to Filipino groups. It did not say whether it would open up more spaces for domestic helpers.
The government says the management committee of a Tuen Mun primary school will make a wise decision on the fate of the school's principal. Otherwise, the Education Bureau may intervene in the school's operation with extreme measures. Caleb Leung has more.
With just over two more weeks to go before the start of a new school term, Heng Tech School in Tuen Mun has yet to resolve its management problems. The Education Bureau earlier demanded a meeting with the school's principal, Chen Chengping, tomorrow. However, Secretary for Education Kevin Young confirmed today that Chen had declined to meet face-to-face. The Bureau is awaiting her written response to a number of issues. As for Chen's fate as principal of the school, Young said the Incorporated Management Committee, or IMC, of Heng Tech School will decide on that at a meeting next Friday. Yuan believes the committee will make a wise decision.
We now have nine school managers appointed by the government, appointed by EDB, to sit in the IMC. Of course, if we spot other problems, and if we see that the IMC, for some reason, suddenly are not performing, we will also consider appointing more managers in the IMC so that the school could operate as normal.
You have also said the Bureau will consider taking extreme measures if needed, including taking over the school's operation. The education chief also talked about the school falsifying the number of students on its enrollment list. He said according to an initial investigation, the school had not received any extra subsidies through the inflated number of students. However, Yang stressed that schools are required to report to the Bureau on students who have been absent from classes for more than 7 consecutive days. Meanwhile, sources say the management committee of Hengtek School is divided on whether to dismiss the principal. At least one committee member said the principal should not be fired, even at the cost of the committee losing its right to operate the school. Caleb Leung, TVB News.
Over 1,000 people took part in a finger-painting session today to celebrate the 20th anniversary of the SAR's return to Chinese rule. The event even broke a world record for the biggest painting ever to be made of fingerprints. People gathered at Chater Garden in Central to see the spectacle. The painting is meant to be a giant bohemia flower. Right, Chris, what do you have for us today? The same boat?
Yeah, kind of a sad end, but an amazing career. Actually, a shocking end to the career of sprinting legend Usain Bolt. At the World Championship in London, he suffered an injury in his final race. Usain Bolt.
The unlikely bronze in the 100 meters and the unthinkable in Usain Bolt's final race, the 4x100 relay. Bolt running the anchor leg completely pulled up with an injury and fell to the track. So ended the career of the 8-time Olympic gold medalist and world record holder in the 100 and 200 meters. Teammate Johan Blake blamed the long wait and cold conditions for Bolt cramping up, while rival Justin Gatlin applauded the 30-year-old Jamaican for all he's done for the sport.
Quick word, you know, I just told him, you know, wish him well. You know, he stood to his feet like a champion, and he applauded, you know, to the crowd and his and all he's done. So I'm just happy with that, and happy that it's not anything serious. He had to take off in a wheelchair, and I think he'll bounce back.
Momentarily lost in all the drama was Great Britain's first gold medal in the event. The United States took silver and Japan the bronze. Meanwhile, Britain's Mo Farah missed out on a fifth major middle distance double. The 10,000 meters world champion finished second to Ethiopian Mukhtar Idris in the 5,000 meters. Farah, a 4-time Olympic champion, will make one final track appearance later this month before shifting his focus to road racing. But order was restored in the women's 4x100 relay. The Americans won gold as Tori Bowie picked up her second gold in London, while Allison Felix earned a record 15th World Championship medal. Jameson Wong, TVB News.
Chelsea opened defensive its English Premier League title with a 3-2 loss to Burnley at Stamford Bridge. The Blues finished the game with 9 men after Gary Cahill and Cesc Fabregas were sent off.
The 3 goals, and I think that we have to improve a lot on this aspect because can happen. A situation of this type.
In other action, Wayne Rooney scored the match winner in his return to Everton. 31-year-old's first half header found the back of the net as the Toffees beat Stoke 1-0 at Goodison Park. Rooney scored his first league goal for Everton as a 16-year-old in 2002. Meanwhile, Liverpool and Watford played to a 3-3 draw. Tennis and Roger Federer advanced to the Montreal Masters final after taking care of Dutchman Robin Haase in 8 sets. Scores here were 6-3 and 7-6. Federer extended his winning streak to 16 matches. 36-year-old meets Germany's Alexander Zverev for the championship. Zverev ended the run of hometown favorite Denis Shapovalov. Fourth seed beat the 18-year-old 6-4 and 7-5. Rising star is coming off a win last week in Washington. Now to some big action from Tahiti. This is Japanese-American Noah Igarashi at the Billabong Pro. The 18-year-old had some of the best tube rides of the day. However, Igarashi failed to make it out of his heat. He was coming off a win last week at his home break in Huntington Beach. World number 29 is expected to represent Japan when surfing debuts at the 2020 Summer Olympics in Tokyo.
And that's our news.
Good night.